I'm Kalekeni Mutalika Banda. Right now I'm retired. I'm a founder of the Banda Bora Sports Foundation. This is what I'm doing right now. So I spend most of my time half the time in Albany, New York. And then I go to Africa for another 4 or 5 months. So that's what I do. I do a project for the children of Malawi, Africa, called Chituka Village Project. Basically, well, the foundation mission is to promote education, because Africa, especially Malawi, does not have a mandate or law that children must go to school. Since I come from Malawi myself, and my village children were the most, you know, underserved people in the country. So I came up with the idea of how do I give back to the village as a coach. And of course, soccer and track and field is my profession, is what I do. So, but I didn't want to go there thinking that I'm going to go coach the youth to play soccer to become professional soccer players. That's not the name. The major objective was to educate the children, at least have some kind of a literacy background where they can know how to read or write and help their family, help themselves solve problems in the village. And my idea is to encourage to attend school. So soccer was my starting point. I said, I'm going to bring some soccer balls to the village so the kids can play at school. But they didn't know what they didn't. I didn't give them the whole idea of why I was doing that. They just, oh, the soccer balls, so let's go play. And they showed up, and then I gave them guidelines. I said, okay, so for you to play, you have to be in school. But the other thing was that girls don't play soccer. So here I was, one of the original soccer coaches in America. I'm trying to bring sports to the village, but the sport I'm trying to bring is soccer. So I had to tell them that for you to get equipment from me, you have to start girls soccer teams. We began with 10 schools, and then we went to 15, and now we're doing like 30 schools. But every one of those schools, they have to have the guidelines that for you to be part of this program for my foundation, we got to have girls also playing. I was born in Lilongwe, we call it a township of Lilongwe, which is now the capital of Malawi. But my father, on my father's side, we're a member of the royal family. And on my mother's side, we're members of Christian-oriented folks. So growing up, I have those two elements in my environment. So that was influential with the group of Malawians to help Malawi become independent. The government was moving well, but the president of Malawi, Kamuzu Banda, had in 1960s, just right after independence, there was an uprising in parliament. So some of the members of the parliament were voted against him. And my father was one of those people who came from the area where the group of parliamentarians or ministers went against the president. So my father was demoted. He was sent back to under house arrest in the village. So we went back to the village, and I went back to my village school and stayed there. And my father was given a chance, a second chance. So since we came from a royal family, Kamuzu, the president, knew that if my father stays around that district, he might come up with some other ideas against his policies. So what he did, he brought him back here and says, I'm gonna make you a diplomat. So you're gonna go to Germany. So it's like, to me, looking back now politically, he was really exiling my father. He didn't want him to be near the people so that they can start discussing how he was gonna take over the government and run it as a dictator, which what happened is that it became a dictatorship. He was a diplomat for Malawi in Germany, West Germany. And after that, we came to America in 1967. So we used to live in Mamaroneck, New York, which is just about 25 miles away from the city. So he was representing Malawi at United Nations, attending Mamaroneck High School, played soccer there, around track and field. And I think I did pretty good. I was an average student, but I was good in sports. I think we were the first African students at Mamaroneck High School. All my classes, I went in, usually just me and my sister in class from Africa. We were diplomats. And so coming from Africa, we are put in an environment where there was no other black people near us. So it was kind of a learning, growing up and understanding, okay, where we are. So we knew that coming from a colonial environment and then coming here, we kind of understood that, okay, you're going to be in a white environment. So you got to get used to that environment and do whatever you can. Our objective was to come to America, get educated, so we've been groomed to go back to Africa, to go back to Malawi and become the leaders in our community, in our village, and hopefully become the leaders in the country. We were trying to do as much as we can in 4 years because we didn't know if the president would change his mind and bring him back again. So every year we were in pins and needles. My father was telling us, hey guys, be serious with school, study hard, because you never know what Malawi, what will happen. Our president in 1968, I believe, he came to UMass, got an honorary degree. So when he came to UMass to get his honorary degree, he talked to University of Massachusetts to have a relationship with Malawi by encouraging to build a school of agriculture, because we're a poor country, so we need to be know how to farm properly. So his mentality was, I got to educate my people to know how to farm, so we're going to be self-sufficient. So UMass and Malawi became a relationship. So that's why we came here. That's why I came to UMass, because I had a scholarship from Malawi government. My father didn't pay for that. So that our students from Malawi used to come to UMass to study, whether it's economics, business, and then they decided that physical education was going to be a major component of the youth movement. So they said, the youth movement, we need to teach our boys and girls to be physically fit. So we're going to start a physical education program in schools. I was being groomed to be one of the national coaches or administrators for sports. So UMass gave us that background. I had a good understanding that this is just a temporary. I need to make sure that I do what I need to do. So when time to go home, I've got all the skills I need to have. When I was introduced to New Africa House, I said, how do I take courses there? Because I'm in the phys ed department. So I said, there's going to be a way how I can take courses in this department. So I figured it out. I told my advisor, I said, how many courses can I take that are in New Africa House? So we went through the list of courses, whether it's philosophy, but mainly African-American history or Black history. So I made sure that every semester I had a class going on at New Africa House. So at least I can be around my people, people who look like me, and really get involved in the Black experience as much as I could, because I was always in a white environment. Not too many Black people were accepted or encouraged to join soccer at UMass. And I made a lot of good soccer players on Sundays or Saturdays. We used to play just below, you know, on weekends with the brothers from Trinidad, from Africa, different countries. But when it came to the team, they were not being recruited to join the soccer team. So I used to find it very strange. I said, why come? So I'd be talking to some of the Black students. I said, why don't you come for the game, to the team? I said, oh, no, I don't want to hang out with those people, man. I said, what's about? So I didn't get it, but I knew something was disconnected. So coming from a political environment in Africa, this was no problem for me to be part of this environment or group of people that I appreciated. Being around, even though maybe we didn't have the same background, but I was able at least to negotiate around campus as another graduate and be seen as part of that group of folks. I was mingling with the, you know, with everybody. So I didn't have to choose. I could mingle with everybody, no problem. But the only time I saw a lot of Black folks was on my track team. The soccer team was just all white. So that's how UMass kind of changed me or taught me to be, you know, I guess to learn and understanding people from different background and know how to get along, how to appreciate, you know, a different segment of people. And I was able, at least, I was diplomatic. I think I learned that from my father. So I was able to mingle. Yeah. After graduation, I went back to Malawi. I stayed in Malawi for 2 years. When I went to Malawi to hoping to be the national coach, and they made me sports officer. My uncle, who was responsible of giving us the program to come to UMass, was detained. He was in prison when I got back to Malawi in 1975. So when I went to look for him to say, where's my position? They start warning me. They says, you cannot mention that you're related to Kalekeni Banda. I said, uh-oh, that's not good. So how am I supposed to get myself the job that I was, you know, I went to train for? So they said, no, things have changed. The government has just changed. That program is no longer. So you're going to have to find a way around and figure out who you need to report to. So I was able to go to the Minister of Sports and Culture and introduce myself. So I had to tell them that I was already in America for four or five years when I got the scholarship. So you don't know me. I was given a warning that Malawi was now very sensitive to people who were being educated abroad, and most of them were being detained or being killed. So you need to keep your mouth shut and stay low and don't ask too many questions. So I was fortunate that my fiance then, she came to Malawi and we got engaged, and I was able to defect without telling anybody. So I really defected Malawi in 1977, and I was able to skip out because that job that was I was promised wasn't going to be coming around. My wife then was coming back to UMass to get her degree. And so we started looking to UMass. Well, maybe I'm going to go back to UMass. There might be something I can do there. So we'll see. And all of a sudden, I hear UMass is going to be hiring. When I started a women's soccer program. So I applied for it. And without knowing, I've never coached women's soccer before, because Malawi doesn't have a women's soccer team. I was just coaching men's soccer and track and field, men and women. When I applied for the job, I sent my paperwork in, my resume in, true story, I never got an acknowledgement that I received my application. They give the job to Annie Morse, who was my former classmate in track and field. Ken O'Brien was our coach, undergraduate. So Annie Morse was working in the track office at the time, and I didn't know. So he was assistant coach to Ken O'Brien, who was our track coach, right? So, but Annie Morse never played soccer in his life. I went to UMass campus looking for, get a locker so I can do some workout. I went upstairs to see Coach O'Brien. So Ken O'Brien, he goes, "Oh, Kenny, come in, sit down." I sit down. He says, "Well, Arnie Morse is looking for an assistant coach." So I went home and told Martha, says, "They give the job to Arnie Morse." And Arnie Morse never played soccer, but he did track and field and cross country. And he was very good at track and field and cross country, very good. He was assistant coach for Ken O'Brien. But since the job was designed for soccer track, the department did not do a search to go out and find qualified people to do that job. That season, I did all the practice, because he had no idea how to do soccer. So I did everything. And I gave him the whistle, he'll blow the whistle and do his thing. And I wrote all the drills and tactics and teamwork about the game and pre-game, post-game. So we're undefeated, and they were going to be going to the playoff. But I got a call from Jerry Quarles, who was a housing director. "Banda, you know, you're on food stamps. I got a job for you." I said, "What? We're hiring for a head of residence. So you got to come for interview this weekend." I'm going, "Oh, no, I got a game." So I went to Annie Morse and told him about it. I said, "Listen, I got a job to make money and feed myself, my wife. So I need to do this interview. So here's the game plan." So I gave him the game plan. He went. And I said, "When you win the first game, I'll come there Sunday and we'll play in the championship." Well, guess what? They lost the game. And the women from my head afterwards, they were not happy. And they came back and wrote the report about the whole season and gave it to the department. The indoor season, outdoor season, ended. I turned in all my keys, my gear, my keys. I get a call that, "Banda, they're looking for you at UMass." So I thought I did something bad. Ken O'Brien was sitting in his office. I went to him first. I said, "Ken O'Brien, why are they looking for me?" And he goes, "Close the door, sit down." He goes, "Banda, there's a job open." I said, "What job open?" He goes, "Soccer and women's track." That's an honest job. He goes, "No, Arn is no longer on the job. What's going on?" So he told me what happened. That the women in the soccer team wrote a letter complaining about he being a soccer coach who doesn't know soccer. To them, that was like a, degrading. So they're going to use Title IX on the university. that you're giving us a coach that doesn't know the sport, right? Banda was doing all the things, and this guy did not. We lost the game, we should have won. If Banda had been there, we would have won that game. So I took over the program. We never missed a beat. We were in Final Four, maybe six straight years. We never missed the NCAA championship. Maybe 35 All-Americans. We played in the five Final Fours. So that's how I began coaching the university soccer team. And I was in the UMass Hall of Fame because of soccer. And I was two-time National Coach of the Year during that time. And we played in that. And then we hosted in the national championship game at UMass. Amherst College came after me before the season. They says, "Who want to hire you to come to Amherst College?" And I said, "No, I can't leave until we win the national championship." So I stayed at UMass. So at that time, UMass wasn't paying a lot of money. So I had two kids, family to feed. And I said, "Well, Amherst might be a good option for me to keep my family together." So after the season, after we lose that game, I went to the department. I said, "Listen, I have an offer, but I don't want to take it. I want to stay here under these conditions. One, I stay as a head coach of women's soccer, and I will assist indoor-outdoor track. But our soccer team is on a national verge. We just lost in the national championship. We have the formula to win in the national championship. So I don't have to go anywhere. If you just allow me to do this, we're good to go." They said, "Well, that's not going to happen. Thank you, but no thank you." And that's how we left. And I said, "Well, I guess I'm not needed. They don't want me, so what am I going to do? And I have to feed my family." So that's why I left UMass.